Country Music Festival Society welcomes you to this evening's concert. Opening the concert this evening, we have the Corps of Drums of the 2nd Battalion, Princess Patricia's Canadian Light Infantry from Winnipeg, Manitoba. For those of you that have been following our concerts, we are indebted to corporate sponsors for these concerts, in particular the Times Colonist and CFAX Radio 1070. Without their support, we would not be able to bring you these concerts. The long-term plans of the Victoria Military Music Festival Society is an annual festival. We are looking at September 2000 as being the first Victoria Military Music Festival known as BandFest 2000. And we are bringing you various awareness building events in advance of September 2000. We will be presenting some free programming for you in the summer, which you will hear about later through the news media. Now for this evening's concert, the band you see on the stage here today, the Band of the Welsh Guards, last appeared in Victoria in 1974. And I would like to introduce you to the director of music, who is no stranger to Victoria. Some of you may recognize him. The director of music of the Welsh Guards, Captain Phil Shannon.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, it's wonderful to be back here again in Victoria. It was just a year ago I stood on this stage thinking I'll probably never be here again. So I dashed around the town and really contributed quite a lot to your economy. This is the kids, auntie, mum, dad, my wife, you know, a couple of things. It was wonderful. I really enjoyed it. And then when I got back from tour from the Prince of Wales' division last year, very sadly actually, the director of music of the Welsh Guards passed away through cancer. And I was given a telephone call and told to get down to the Welsh Guards post haste. So that's why I end up here on this stage again, and have been looking forward to it for a long time. I've run around this afternoon. I have yet again, in fact, we've all contributed quite significantly to the... I don't think there's a t-shirt left in some of the shops. But it's a delight to be here tonight, and a tremendous end to our six-week tour of Washington State. And we were giving shows in Vancouver just, was it last night? It was that night. If you notice that they're a bit nonplussed, this is our 30th show, but it's going to be the best one, so we've saved the best to last. I was asked when we were making the program, Roger asked me, he said, you must play something Welsh to start off with. Men of Harlech would do nicely, thank you very much indeed. And as he was feeding us and looking after us and housing us and making sure that we're not camping out in tents, I said, Roger, if you want Men of Harlech, that's what it's going to be. Here we go, Men of Harlech.
Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Well, those of you who have had any connection with the military probably had your feet tapping. And you probably forgot all about those times when the regimental sergeant major was standing on your hair and all the rest of it. All those cold days spent trudging up and down parade squares. It suddenly disappears into the mist, doesn't it? Well, there we go, a lovely Welsh number to open up with. I don't know how many of you heard a little chat I gave on the radio just the other day. It ended up, I thought it was going to be 5 minutes, it ended up being half an hour, but it was quite funny what happened. I was given this mobile phone, given a number and said, ring this number, you're on at 11 o'clock. So I thought, I was in the middle of Vancouver, and I thought to myself, well, it's quite easy, all I do is just go and find a quiet corner somewhere. Well, could I find a quiet corner? I thought, I'll go down to the marine area, because it must be quite quiet there. And I sat on some rocks and heard the gentle lapping of the sea, and I thought, this is so picturesque, I'll be able to chat on the live link, oh, no problem. And then a seaplane took off next door. And then another one came in, and I thought, this is no good. And then they started drilling just across the way, and they're putting a new roadway in there. So I thought, what am I going to do? I mean, they can't have this in the radio. So I went along to one of the cruise ships that were there, and I saw somebody mopping the decks, and I said, excuse me, do you mind if I came on board your ship and chatted on the radio? He said, oh yeah, please come aboard. And chatting to him, I said, well, what sort of things do you do here? He said, oh, all sorts of cruises. We do lots of funerals as well. I thought, oh, that's a good one. A bit of a strange cruise ship to be on there, but funerals at sea, would you believe? But anyway, it was great. I was able to sit in the glassed area. Thankfully, one of our guests, who we'll be meeting later on, was chatting, these seaplanes were roaring in and out, and it wasn't too disturbing. So if you've come as a result of the radio broadcast, lovely to see you. We're going to move on and play an overture now. It's a very old-fashioned, in many respects, overture, written by Rossini. And Rossini was a great man for melody in the opera world. He wrote some 37 operas, quite a staggering amount, probably the most operas that anyone has actually ever written and seen perform. And really, it's quite staggering to think that for the last 37 years of his life, he didn't write a note of opera music. All he did was a few sacred items. And so when you think of this particular overture, it comes amongst a whole bunch of others. Sit back, relax, and enjoy the Barber of Seville. Thank you. You may have read in the press that we were the only band ever to come on tour without any instruments. And if you weren't aware of that, that is actually what happened on the latter part of this particular leg of the tour. What happened was the Royal Air Force, excuse me, any ex-Royal Air Force, decided in their wisdom that it would be lovely to take our instruments, all the freight together, and fly it back early. We were due to have all this coordinated so that we had everything, all our stand banners, everything we needed, and they decided to push the flights forward. So I rang Canada and I said, look, we're on the verge of not coming, can you help us out? And they said, well, what we can do is find you instruments, don't worry about it, everything will be okay. You just come up, just bring yourselves up with your uniforms, everything will be sorted out. Well, ladies and gentlemen, if I say to you that it would be the equivalent of asking each one of you to get into a totally different car without automatic transmission, manual drive, and come here tonight, you'd be coming in, you know, sort of bits and pieces all over the place. It would be rather unfamiliar. Well, that's actually what happened. As we gave a concert two nights ago, 1 hour before, there were still instruments arriving in the wings. And what was happening was frightening, because the gentleman had the mouthpieces, obviously, for especially the trombones. We play with the large bore mouthpieces, and they tried to slot the mouthpieces into the end of the trombones and suddenly discovered that they were small bore trombones. So we've used sticky tape, elastoplast, just about everything to make things work. So it's been a bit of a struggle. So you're seeing a band here who's quite willing to go on the road without any instruments. Sounds a bit Irish, it says to me. I'm going to be sharing the conducting tonight with a colleague. We have in the household division two conductors usually in the bands, myself as the director and also the bandmaster. Please give a very warm welcome to bandmaster Paul Greener.
We had someone short here. Well, good evening. You're probably a bit confused as to why we have two conductors. So before I conduct something, maybe I'll just explain a little about my role in life. Now, in addition to conducting the band and standing for the direction of music on state occasions in the war, Queen's Guard mounting, all the sorts of engagements which we'd normally perform, my job is split into two other separate areas. The first one is what we call continuation training. So when musicians come and join the band, having done their basic army training, and probably about a year's additional music study at the Royal Military School of Music in Ellerhall in Twickenham. They come to the band as a class three musician, and we have three different classes, the highest being class one. So a lot of my time is spent teaching musicians the theoretical aspects and orchestration technique and oral perception, so they can pass these additional examinations and get increments of pay. When they get further on in their career, after that, they're required to do courses to gain promotion to sergeant, and again later on for promotion to sergeant major. So again, they come back and I do a prep for that before they go off and take their examinations for that. So that's one side of life. And the other side of life, which was very important to us, is recruiting. We have a very highly maintained band. Personnel-wise, we're completely up to strength, and we're allowed to have 49 playing members of the band at any one time. But because we have a career cycle which spans about 22 years on average, it means that people are continually leaving the army, so we have to keep an eye out for the untalented players to come in and take their place. So that takes up a lot of time. To give you some idea of that, in an average year, or last year, for instance, we looked at had applications for over 200 musicians who'd like to come and join us. From there, we selected 54 to actually have a listen to and see how they are coming on. And from those, we selected four. So this is one a week, and take one every 3 months. So that keeps me fairly well tied up. Of course, one of the aspects of being a state band is that we have a certain amount of appeal to young musicians within the British Isles, because of our name, our prestige, and where we're actually based in the centre of London. And some musicians regard us as a stepping stone to breaking into the West End circuit or the professional music circuit. I'm pleased to say that most of the time, once they get to us, they enjoy it so much they decide not to go on. But anyway, they come along to us, and as I said, they look at that as a stepping stone to the West End, which leads me nicely to the next piece of music, because being in the centre of London, we like to keep abreast of what's going on in town. And one of the biggest hits in recent years, the music from, or the hit, Les Miserables, which we'll play for you now.
Thank you.
sure will be familiar with the film Lawrence of Arabia. The film, of course, depicts the last 2 years of the First World War, where Lawrence was instrumental in uniting the various Arab tribes to form an uprising, which eventually overcame the oppressive rule of the Turkish Ottoman Empire, leading to the capture of Damascus. But the film music that was written by Maurice Jarry, and it was a particularly good score. In fact, he won first of three Oscars for this particular score in 1962. He went on to win a further two, one for Dr. Zhivago in 1965, and Passage to India in 1984. On top of that, he's written many film scores. I can't possibly list them all, but a few of them would be Is Paris Burning, no particular chronographical order here, or I don't know, Ghost, or let me think now. One I'm sure you all know, Mad Max Beyond the Thunderdome. Have you all seen that one? I look at the sort of people who would go and see that, so that's some surprise. But anyway, this particular score, the reason he won an Oscar for it, is self-evident. It's a wonderful piece of music, very, very descriptive. It conjures up vast images of an endless golden sand in the desert, and the theme of Lawrence, of course, from the film. So imagine you're in the desert now while we play you the theme from Lawrence of Arabia.
Thank you.
fairly modern composer, Cacaturian, in England. He's very, probably most famous for a piece of music that was used for a theme to a television series, which was a big hit some many years ago now, called The Unneeding Line. Was that ever shown over here? It was lovely music. Do you know what it was called? Okay, it was a theme from Spartacus. So that was actually written by Cacaturian. But seeing as you nearly all know that one, we're not going to play that. I'm going to play a piece. No, I'm sure you'll know this piece as well. It's probably is equally well known, and it's Cacaturian's Sabre Dance.
Group, some of us, in Hawaii recently. No reactions from the band. I usually think, yes, I can see some of them looking over their glasses at me. We were asked by some of the Canadians to accompany them down to take part in the Hawaii Twilight Tattoo. And I couldn't do anything else but say, well, of course I'd be delighted to. So two of the members of the band came down as well, the two with suntans, is it that they're just blushing? We went down there and we had the opportunity of working with these particular gentlemen, and over the past year I've had the opportunity of working with them as well. They're a super bunch of people. We really have enjoyed it, and Roger McGuire heads it up as pipe manager. Ladies and gentlemen, please give a very warm welcome to the pipes and drums of the Canadian Scottish Regiment.
It seems appropriate to start the second half off with a good old-fashioned British march. It's the sort of thing that we'd play on a daily basis, but perhaps this might be what you'd actually like to hear us play a little bit of when you come to see a military band, so I hope you actually did want to hear that. Interesting thing about that march, or not that march to pose it, his real name is Fred Ricketts. He didn't have quite the same ring to it as Kenneth Alford. So, seems in competition with, you know, John Philip Sousa, who's the British equivalent. So, that's how he came to change his name. He was a graduate of Nella Hall in 1908, British Army Bandmaster. He served 28 years in the British Army as Bandmaster of the 2nd Battalion, the British Army, 2nd Battalion Argyll and Southern Highlanders, before transferring to the Royal Marines as their Director of Music. Well done to you, close, but no cigar. Anyway, how do we follow that march? Just before I forget where I am and start making mistakes, I think I'll quit while I'm ahead. We're going to play a piece now, which is a selection of big band numbers, and it's called Big Bands in Concert. Thank you. thank you. The next piece is a piece of music by a composer who's very, very little known in the West. Glieri was a very prominent post-revolution in Russia. He was a nationalistic composer, spent a great deal of his life collecting traditional Russian folk songs and annotating for various ensembles. But he was very influential on other Russian composers as a teacher, including Kakaturin, who heard a piece from earlier, and also Prokofiev, whose music is far more widely known in the West. There's really only one piece of music that found great fame over here, and that was his ballet, The Red Poppy. And the next piece is from that, and it's called The Russian Sailor's Dance.
In the end of that one as well. I said on the radio the other day that I would just let you into a few of the things that happen behind closed doors with regard to our job with dealing with Her Majesty the Queen and all that goes on there. Many of you, I'm sure, will have been to the changing of the guard at Buckingham Palace and know what happens there. And if you do come over, you'll notice that, in fact, the Welsh Guards, the uniforms that are arranged, and somebody asked me this on the radio today, I think you're here tonight, was it Bill or Jack? Are you really in here somewhere? What the configuration of buttons mean. Now, you notice that they're grouped into files on the front and also on the cuffs here. And that's because we're fifth in line. You've got the Grenadier Guards. They were here recently, weren't they? I was going to say, if you don't like our performance tonight, we're the Grenadier Guards, right? And then you've got the Coldstream Guards, the Scots Guards, the Irish Guards, and the Welsh Guards. And if you go to Buckingham Palace, you'll be able to tell from a distance who's on guard by the groupings of the buttons either singly, in twos, threes, fours, or fives. So the American tourists who are standing next to you can wax lyrical. And it's quite interesting as she's standing inside the palace, some of the things that they come out with. Not necessarily American tourists, but tourists in general, like, gee, hasn't he got a big hat? You hear all sorts of things. The Japanese ones, I'm sorry, I can't understand it, but they all giggle anyway, you know. That's life outside the palace. And then there's the inner quadrangle, and when we have state visits, and you have either presidents or heads of state come in to have an audience with the Queen, then they usually roll up in their cars or carriages, and there's a band there, Guard of Honour, and we play for them. And the Queen comes out, she's about as near as that wall, and she stands and waits for us for a change, which is very interesting. And we play the national anthem, and then they usually inspect the guard. And then we go inside the palace for investitures, and I know you're familiar in Canada with the honours system, but knighthoods, Order of the British Empire, Member of the British Empire, whatever it might be, and we, I'll say the gentlemen here, and ladies, because we've just got our first two ladies in the band, they arrived 3 days before we left, set sail for So the musicians, I should say, form an orchestra. There's many of these players, very talented. They play not only one, two, three, and four instruments. And so we form an orchestra and we play music that the Queen will greet the person who's about as far away as that microphone stand. And we have got to gauge the music so that she can talk to the person, but yet the other folk in the front row who are about as near as just a bit further than the railing there cannot hear what is said. So the music is a mask really for that. And if we get too loud, there's a red light that comes on. If we get too quiet, there's a green light. That's all very, very controlled. And you know, if you go there for the day, it's wonderful. Oh, nice little orchestra up there. And we're upstairs in these tunics, you know, playing solidly, one number after another. Red light, green light, red light, just right, you know. So that's some of the things that we have to do, and all the bands of the household division have to do the same sort of thing. We've got 5 foot guards bands and then 2 on horseback, and you usually see them at Queen's Birthday Parade. I don't know if it's beamed out here in June. Does the Queen's Birthday Parade come out? Yeah. Oh, it's still right. Well, you'll see us on there. I'm not sure you'll actually recognise it, but we'll be there. I can't say we'll give you a wave, but we're in the back somewhere. We're going to move on and play a lovely march by Ron Goodwin, who started his early life arranging for military bands and went into the BBC Radio Orchestra many, many years ago and has written film scores for The Day of the Triffids and Murder on the Orient Express, 633 Squadron. If you look at his bibliography, it's a mile long. This is one we enjoy. It's Aces High or the Luftwaffe March.
Thank you.
modern play film scene. Now you may be familiar with the film The Mission. It was out, I think, quite a number of years ago, but the film score was done by one of the greats in film music, and that was Ennio Morricone. And he wrote, well, The Good and the Bad and the Ugly springs to mind as one of his scores, but he is very, very well respected and very well known in the film industry. This particular piece features an instrument which you only normally have one or even two of in a band, and certainly the same amount in an orchestra, and that is the oboe. We're going to introduce to you Sergeant Julian Kirk to play for you The Mission.
Thank you.
marching on parade to something like that, which is a real mood change. I hope that the next time you hear that theme, it will remind you of our night together here. We will actually be mixing around in the foyer afterwards. I'm always keen to meet folks, especially folks from Ireland, where I'm from. Folks from Wales, you know, it doesn't matter, wherever you're from, would like to say hello. I will be here until the last person goes. They're heading to the Swan. So, so if you want to, if you can't get to speak to us and you want to come and buy them a drink in the Swan. they heard that bit, you see. It's amazing what they can hear on stage here. But if you do want to end up in the Swan, that's where they'll be. And so I don't know what quite will be going on there, but I think that a few drinks are going to pass a few minutes. We're going to be heading out of here tomorrow morning, sadly, and back to Fort Lewis, pack up the rest of our equipment, and fly out on Tuesday after 6 weeks. So we're looking forward to getting home, but we'll take more than a little taste of Canada back with us. We're going to feature one of our sections now. It's the clarinet section, the section that always say to me that they work the hardest. I kind of doubt that at times, but I don't know. They're really the violin players of the band. They always seem to be very busy in the front. Whether they're always playing the right notes, we're never quite sure. But we're going to play a lovely piece of music written by Leroy Anderson, who had great fame with the Boston Pops Orchestra. And it's a little bit of music called Clarinet Candy. Did they play all the right notes or what? I hope so. We've been working very much in the schools in the Washington area, or the, I should say the Seattle area, and we've had a lot of fun there actually. It's been great. I'd love to see some young people in here tonight, some children. We always try and encourage the young people to come and get interested in music, because if you're interested in music and you get playing in bands and orchestras, then you're not up to other things which are perhaps not so good. But we've got this rather unusual instrument. The children are fascinated by this because the xylophone usually ends up right behind the band, and the percussionists, well, they're the kind of the kitchen sink department. You'll see them rattling and shaking all sorts of things there. They seem to come up with something new each time. And this instrument's usually made of wood, and the long bits here at the bottom are the low notes, and obviously the little pieces of wood at the top are the little notes. And these two gentlemen have been having a lot of fun. They even had, dare I say, water pistols. Do you call them water pistols out here? Squirt guns, I think the American called. And they're having great fun with the children, but demonstrating really that music can be a lot of fun. And we're going to introduce you to a little bit of music. I think, actually, shall we go for the record tonight of how fast we can do it? So some of you are in let's try it, shall we? This is called The Two Imps. The Two Imps. Now, you will behave yourselves, gentlemen, won't you? I'm not so sure. Here we go with a very fast Two Imps. Somebody else that I only talked to on the link the other day. I actually met for the first time today, and that's our guest for this evening, Tanya Elizabeth, and you're going to meet her now. So Tanya, do come on stage, let's give her a round of applause. Is that right? Not quite. Tanya, I was quite surprised to see that you've just released your first CD, is that right?
Yeah, I released it in September.
Wow, how's it doing?
It's doing okay.
Is it going to do better after tonight?
I hope so.
Oh, is that a plug to say that they're on sale? Yeah, they will be on sale after. And you'll be able to sign them and things like that?
Sure.
Sure, yeah, that's an extra $5, is it, yeah? Well, I actually sprang on Tanya tonight and said, would you, instead of putting out the band item, because we would love to hear you play, and having heard you on the radio, I thought, oh, this is great. It takes me back to my roots in dear old Ireland. So would you perhaps play us a little tune now before we do our item together? Great. What's it going to be called?
Tamlin's Real Into Metropolitan.
Splendid. Well, here we go. Miss Tanya Elizabeth. Stephen Grappelli invited this young fellow on the stage, and that young fellow was Nigel Kennedy, who went on to be, you know, quite a renowned figure. So I think, as long as you change your name to Elizabeth or something like that, you're going to be really big in Ireland. Okay? We're going to play a little bit of music now, which is from The Last of the Mohicans. It's a very atmospheric piece, and it features not only the violin, it features our friends on the bagpipes and also the drums. Here we go with the Gael. only joking. We have to catch up on all the stories when we get back, because as the Grenadiers left, we came in, so we're only hearing that they've been various places, and obviously had a great time, very well received wherever they went, so that's tremendous. And as Roger mentioned at the very beginning, he's hoping to bring more bands back in next year. We have already been approached. I don't know. Would you like us to come back? It is difficult to hear on stage. They say they buy you a drink, okay? Oh, they heard, yes, I heard. Well, ladies and gentlemen, sadly, we've come to our finale tonight. It's the last movement of Bizet's L'Arlésienne, and it's a rather fast and furious little, it almost goes like a fugue. It starts lam tam 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 tri, and in between that, you've also got the tune starting on the second beat of the bar and on the next beat of the bar. Do you call them bars or measures here? Oh, you do. In the Americans, we have to translate everything, you know. We've got to be careful at times, because some of the words they use, we use in ordinary language, and we suddenly have shocked looks, you know. Anyway, it's as we get towards the end, it does speed up, and it's very cleverly written, and you'll be able to hear the tune coming in all sorts of areas in the band, right down through over to the tubas here. Here we go with Bizet's L'Arlésienne.
Thank you.
you so much, Lady, for your warm applause and for making us feel so much home tonight. We really have felt a great affinity with you, so thank you very much indeed for supporting the evening. We're going to play some regimental marches now, and we're going to be joined by the pipe. Section of this, we're going to keep it nice and quiet, and at the end you can do whatever you want. Here we go with the Radetzky March!